In fact, I do not know why I am so sad. I am sick of this sadness. You say that it makes you tired, but I do not know how I got it, found it, or got it. I have still to find out what thing it is made of, or from what it is born. This sadness makes me so foolish that I have great difficulty in knowing or understanding myself. You are thinking about the ocean. Your thoughts are there where your big ships with grand sails are sailing in the sea. These big ships of you tower above small ships engaged in petty traffic. These small ships show respect to them by bowing and saluting when they pass by them, just as the nobles and wealthy merchants walk proudly when they pass through the crowds of common people in the streets. Your ships present a very impressive spectacle on the sea. Believe me, sir, if I had such a business risk at sea, the greater parts of my feelings and thoughts would be my hopes of the safety of my ships on the sea. In such a case, I should always be plucking blades of grass and throwing them in the wind to know which way the wind blew. I should always be looking into maps to find out safe ports, landing platforms, or jetties and anchorages for my ships. And everything that could harm my ships at sea would surely make me sad. If my ships laden with goods were at sea, my own breath cooling my soup would make me tremble with fever caused by the thought that a storm at sea might do great harm to my ships. If I would see the sand running out of the hourglass, I would think of the shallow waters and sandbanks and would bring before my eyes the sight of my richly laden ship. Andrew stuck in the sand capsizing with its sails and masts plunging low and getting buried in the sand while the sides of the ship stood above them where it meets its burial and makes its grave. If I go to church, the stones of the holy building would at once suggest to me the dangerous rocks in the sea which, when they strike my wooden ship, would scatter on the waves the rich spices and cover them with the silks which my ship contains. And briefly, the fear of such an accident would make me think that my ship, which was worth so much, would be reduced to nothing. If I could think all this in my mind, there is no wonder that I should also be able to think of the effect of all these losses on my mind, which, if they happen, would make me sad. But you should not deny it. I'm sure that Antonio is sad because of his goods. Believe me, this is not so. I'm thankful to my good luck that all my merchandise is not carried on board one ship, nor are all my ships gone to one place, nor does all my wealth depend upon the trade of the current year. Therefore, it is not due to my business that I'm sad. Then it must be love which is making you so sad. Shame on you. Your suggestion is sheer nonsense. If love is also not the reason for your sadness, then let us say that you are sad because you are not happy. So it should be easy for you to laugh and jump about and say that you are happy because you are not sad. I swear by the two-headed Roman god of doors named Janus that nature has given strange temperaments to people whom she made since she started her work. There are some people who always laugh. They keep their eyes half shut and they laugh even at petty matters as the parrots laugh even at a bagpiper. There are others who have such sadness appearances that they will not open their lips to laugh at things even when a serious-minded person like Nestor were to swear that the joke was worth laughing at. Here comes Bassanio, your most noble relation. Graciano and Lorenzo are with me. We bid you farewell and leave you now in better company. I would have waited till I had made you happy and cheerful if these worthier and more respectable friends of yours had not come. I have great respect for you. I understand that you have some business of your own and you take the opportunity to leave me. Good morning, my good lords. Good gentlemen, please let me know when we shall be together to make merry. Please do tell me, you are growing extremely strange or distant in your behavior with me. Must you behave in that way? My lord Bassanio, since you have found Antonio, your dear friend, Graciano and I will like to take leave of you, but I request you not to forget that we have to meet at dinner. I will definitely meet you. You do not look well, Mr. Antonio. I believe that you think too much about worldly matters. You perhaps do not know that those who feel too much anxiety about the world ultimately lose all interest in it. You are greatly changed. I do not attach more importance to the world than it really deserves, Graciano. The world, I think, is a stage where every human being comes to play his or her part, and I have a serious and sad role to play. So far as I am concerned, I will like to play the role of clown or comic actor. Let me make merry and keep laughing and thus grow old and wrinkled. I would rather drink and inflame my liver than let my heart be cooled by sad cries and sighs that shorten life. If a man has warm blood in his body, why should he sit motionless like the marble statue of his grandfather? Why should he appear to be asleep when he is actually awake? Why should such a man get jaundice being serious and ill-natured? I will tell you the truth, Antonio. I love you, and it is my love that is speaking. There is a kind of men whose faces are calm and passive like the surface of stagnant pool of water. They purposely wear this unchanging expression so that people may have the opinion that they are wise, serious, and deep thinking because of their power of imagination. Such persons wish to be considered as Sir Oracle, as the Greek oracles who were inspired by divine wisdom and vision, whose utterances should in reality be believed by others when they speak, and what they speak should not be challenged. Oh, my Antonio, I do know about these people that they are called wise only because they say nothing. In fact, I am very sure that if they do speak, they would damn the hearers, because the hearers would be compelled to call them fools. I shall tell you more about this subject at some other time, but do not try to win this kind of reputation for wisdom by using a serious expression as a bait is used to catch fish. Come, good Lorenzo, let us go. I bid you farewell for a while. I will finish my lecture after dinner. Well, we will leave you now and meet you at dinner. I must be like the silent wise man of whom Graciano was just speaking about, because Graciano never lets me speak. Well, stay with me only for the next 2 years, and you will not be able to recognize the sound of your own voice. I bid you farewell. I will have to become a talkative person because of what you told me. I thank you truly in all faith for taking my advice. Silence is desirable only in the dried tongue of an ox or in a girl who has no chance of getting married. Is there any sense in the remark of Graciano? Graciano talks a lot of nonsense, more than any other man in Venice. The sense in Graciano's talk is hardly equal to 2 grains of wheat, which lie hidden in a large quantity of chaff. You have to go on searching all day before you can find those 2 grains. And when you find them, you will realize that they are not worth the search. Well, tell me now, which is the lady to whom you had promised to make a secret visit? You had promised to tell me about her today. You know well, Antonio, that I have greatly wasted my wealth or property by maintaining a somewhat higher standard of living than my limited means would allow. Nor do I feel sorry for being forced to give up this grand style of living. My main worry now is to be honorably free from the great debts in which I have become involved due to my extravagant living in my youth. Antonio, to you I owe the most in money and love, for you have given me both. You love me, and this love gives me the right or permission to disclose to you all my plans and purposes for getting clear of these rights. I request you, Bassanio, to tell me your plans. If your plans are honorable, as you yourself are, then my wealth, myself, and my entire resources will be made available to you to use as you require. In my school days, when I had lost one arrow, I fired another arrow of the same power of flight or quality in the same direction, keeping a more careful watch to find the first arrow. Thus, by taking risk with both the arrows, I often found both. I have put forward this proof based on the experience of my childhood because what I am going to tell you is pure innocence. You know, Antonio, that already I am deeply in debt to you. Like a self-willed or careless young man, I have spent all the money I borrowed. But if you are prepared to shoot a second arrow in the same direction, I'm sure that I will find either both the arrows or at least bring back the second arrow which you risk. I'm sure of this because I will watch your aim carefully. If not so, I will at least be able to pay you back the money which you give me now and thankfully remain under obligation to you for your first loan. You know me well, and by talking in a roundabout manner, you are only wasting time. This shows that you doubt my love for you in acting or behaving like this. You are being more unfair to me by doubting my readiness to do my utmost for you than you would be in wasting all my wealth. You have simply to tell me what I must do, bearing in mind what it is possible for me to do. As soon as you say it, I am prepared to do it. So let me know what you expect. In Belmont, there is a lady who has been left a lot of wealth. She is beautiful, but even more beautiful than her face are her wonderful virtues. Sometimes, from her eyes, I got speechless messages of love. Her name is Portia, and she is not in the least inferior to Cato's daughter and Brutus' wife, Portia. The vast world is not unaware of her beauty and virtue, because high-born and well-known suitors come from four corners of the world. Her golden locks of hair rest on her temples like golden wool. Because of this, her house in Belmont is like Colchos coast, to which many Jasons come to find her. Oh, my dear Antonio, if I had the money to hold a place equal to the other men ready to marry Portia, my mind foretells such success that I would surely be lucky in winning this lady. You know that all my goods are on board ships which have gone to sea. I have neither ready money nor goods on the strength of which I could raise money to meet your requirements. Therefore, go and try if you can get any money in the city of Venice as a loan on my behalf. I shall extend my credit to the utmost to find money and to enable you to make a journey to Belmont, where the pretty Portia lives. Go at once and find out where money can be got, and I'm sure that I shall be able to get it either on my credit or for the sake of your friendship.